Welcome to the Austin Biz Buzz, the podcast that builds the buzz about Austin business. So kick up your feet and turn your brain on. It's time to talk Austin business right now. Here's Herdy.
Hey, welcome everybody to the Austin Biz Buzz. That's right, we build the buzz about Austin business, and we want you guys to know that we've been covering Austin business for almost 5 years. This used to be the Herdy Burke Broadcast Network. We relaunched as the Austin Biz Buzz. You'll be able to find us after the podcast recording. You'll be able to find us on Apple, Google, YouTube, and the Herdy Burke Broadcast Network on Facebook. So we also want to thank our sponsor, Money Coach LLC, Mike O'Neill, for sponsoring all these podcasts for the next year, which is awesome. It's always good to have a sponsor, and we're just super excited to have him on board on the Austin Biz Buzz. And tonight, our guest is Gary Seale, Trucon, Principal Trucon.
Trucon is the abbreviations of the word truth and conscientiousness, which is the underlying values of the company.
That's awesome. And so we're going to run through some questions with Gary tonight. And Gary, feel free to ad-lib in between some of these questions. I know our crack producers really came up with some great questions. That would be you, sir.
Okay.
You know, so we love to have our guest on here and help support Austin business. So, Gary, you ready to dive into some of your questions?
Absolutely.
Why is it important to have a clearly defined target market?
Because it's all too common for people to feel like everyone, whether they're in business through consumer or B2B, to be a prospect or a customer, when in fact that's rarely true. And the bottom line on this is you can just consume a lot of time, energy, and money marketing and selling into the wrong people and end up with no revenue. And that makes it a critical function. Therefore, it means it's very important for you to define who you're going to go prospect, market to, and try to sell to versus spinning your wheels.
So what I think I heard you just say is if you throw a bunch of stuff up against the wall and you don't have a target market, you're probably going to do a lot of work for very little revenue. Is that what I just
said? Not enough is going to stick.
I guess it's critical to have a differentiation message for your company. What do you mean by a differentiation message?
You have to differentiate yourself simply because there's so much competition. I've never been in an industry or business yet that did not have competition. And in today's sales and marketing world, there's so much information available and so many competitors, and if you can't differentiate yourself, you're going to fall behind. There needs to be a reason to answer the question, why should I buy from you?
I think more important than anything is we almost have to have something that doesn't sound flat like everybody else, right? That's kind of what. So does niche fall into that a little bit?
Yeah, I think that's another way to define the fact that you, at least when you start out, you need to have a narrowly defined niche or market, and then you might be able to expand as your business grows and you bring on more associates with more skill sets that you can provide expertise out to a broader set.
And I think anybody that's been in business for any period of time realizes that you will stumble into that and have to fix that. That's just part of growth. So, Gary, this is going to be a real deep question in the sense that there's a lot of there's a couple answers to this, but it really is true. And that is when how can an owner that's tasked with sales responsibility, and that could be a business, right? Find ways to, and this is great, I love this, get everything done. How's that possible?
That is the $99 question, because I have been in those shoes for many years. And I think the thing that you have to do as a business owner who, for all intents and purposes, is a solopreneur, that you're actually handling sales, logistics, accounting, finance, you know, insurance, everything that it takes to run a business, that if you don't carve some time out to handle the sales and marketing aspect of things, then you're going to find that operations literally killed your business, because it's so easy to get pulled into an operations mode. It's clear, it's evident, and it's, you know, self-evident. And sales can get pushed back till 4:45 in the afternoon.
And yep.
Finally going to get to it, and you're just too cotton pick and tired to do it. You push it back to the next day, and the very same thing happens. Carve out 2 or 3 hours out of your day. If you're new in the business, it should probably be 60% of your time doing sales and marketing functions until you can afford to hire some part-time help, outsource it, automate some things of that nature. Sales can get pushed back to the last priority when, in fact, it should be very close to number one, if not always your number one priority.
Yeah, you know, Gary, I'm kind of that guy because I can tell you from being a solopreneur, an entrepreneur, a single business owner, that you can be overwhelmed with sitting around doing all your organizational stuff, like you said, keeping up the accounting, keeping up with your contact management database, fooling around on email, checking social. And then all of a sudden you realize, you know what? I really need to be out working on the sales side of my business, right? And I tell you, I honestly get up every morning, the first thing I think is, today I need to focus on sales. So it's a priority, right? In the sense that you really have to get disciplined in your scheduling.
If you want a good insight there, you could grab Gary Keller's book, The One Thing, where they talk about setting aside a block of time, tells you that's what you are to do your time. You should probably take their advice over mine.
Yeah, and mine
too. Very important.
good point. So, okay, so I notice you've got, you call it a vision statement, and that's an important factor in your, you know, your morale and the moral support of your employees. I used to call that a mission statement. Tell me a little bit about what you mean by vision statement.
Okay, a vision statement is where and what you want your company to become in the future. And consequently, when you hammer that out in your mind, you get it down on paper and you communicate it not only back to yourself, but your employees, it gives people a hope for the future that there is some aspect of where you want this thing to go. And it's just not loosey-goosey, pell-mell, whatever may happen type of thing. So without a vision, you lose hope. And when you lose hope, you lose energy. And ultimately, you lose your staff, your people, and then you lose that concept of hope for yourself, and you just let the wind go out of your sail. The vision gives you the big 30,000-foot picture of where you're going versus a mission statement.
Ah, okay.
Contribute to your vision statement, but that should be when you're on a phone call, you're doing something on your computer, you're talking to somebody, you're going to a networking meeting, a luncheon, a dinner. So a great example is when you see one of the local police cars or county sheriff's cars, they always have something that says something along the lines to serve and protect. You know, two concepts right there that the police have of what they should be doing with their time. You should be able to articulate that. You know, what am I doing with my time right now that's part of my mission statement that contributes to the big picture?
Yeah, gotcha. Okay, so there, now I see a difference. So you look at the vision statement as kind of the helicopter view, and then the mission statement is implemented in your day-to-day operations, as I understand you just said.
That is correct. And that way, when you find yourself off track, you should be able to correct it.
Okay, Gary, we're going to take a short break and hear from our sponsor. Guys, we'll be back in about less than 20 seconds, so we'll be right back.
Football season is here, and think of how important it is for all the football team to be on the same page. It's just as important for your project management office to be on the same page, too. You need to use the same templates. You need to take the same steps. You need to use the same processes because, you see, consistency breeds competency. And you need to be the ultimate best with your project management office. Money Coach LLC can make your project management office more consistent. They can make you more profitable. Come see us and let us help work with you on the project management office. That's Money Coach LLC.
Okay, Gary, we're back, and we want to keep rolling through these questions on the podcast tonight. We are with Gary Seale. He is the principal of Trucon Sales Consulting, and we're glad to have you on the podcast, Gary, and thanks for the questions and the answers so far. So what is the importance for your company's digital marketing effort to be active and ongoing?
20, 25 years ago, let's just say that PCs started to become popular in the early 90s. There was a great deal of investigation. Now we have more of a firm infrastructure built out there with LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and all these guys. And it's relatively inexpensive. And the real bottom line on this is one of the places that people are looking for information besides your website, which I consider part of your digital marketing effort. 60 to 80% of the people have already done research on their particular topic or area of interest in your company before you're ever contacted as an individual sales contributor. So you have to understand that if you don't have some aspect of digital marketing out there, you're missing a significant possibility of gaining market share and business. Now, the other aspect of this whole thing is that when your prospect finally gets in touch with you as a sales contributor, you need to have an in-depth knowledge of your product, your industry, and how those things function together so it actually contributes to your prospect's well-being. If you don't have that and all you do is regurgitate what's on your website or you fumble around, you're in trouble. Digital marketing is critical. It's important. It doesn't have to be terribly expensive. Although, you know, once you get into some aspects of perhaps ad buying and purchasing, things of that nature, which I know Herdy could contribute a great deal more than myself, you have to be very cautious so you can spend a lot of money there. But just think about Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter are absolutely free. All you have to do is dedicate the time to participate.
Yeah, and I've always said, and when I do presentations, Gary, I always say, in today's market, they know you before you know them, correct?
Absolutely, yeah. It's rare that they would not.
Right. So this is a good time to find out. Gary, you have a website. What's your website so people can go out and look for you?
It's simply TruconBD, TruconBD.com. And from that standpoint, I differentiate between digital marketing, a sales interaction, and then I also contribute to my income and promotion of the business by doing speeches and public talks and things of that nature.
Awesome. And also, what's the best way you like to be contacted, from the website, or do you like people to call you directly or through email?
I'm personally a big email guy. I'm on that thing like 15 hours a day.
Okay.
Then I'm still a landline guy. I certainly do have a cell phone, but when I'm working on the desktop, and the landline is right here at 512-219-6677. If I don't pick up, leave me a message. I'll call you back within 6 to 8 working hours, if not sooner.
All right, and you want to give them your email also?
Yeah, once again, it's Trucon, T-R-U-C-O-N, at sbcglobal.net.
How can a sales manager for a company, you know, guys overseeing his sales staff, how can he make sure he's working directly or calling on the true, quote, decision maker?
Yeah, that's important, especially for someone relatively new in sales that's still a little bit nervous about their capabilities and learning their product. They'll virtually speak to anyone, and unfortunately anyone doesn't cut it. You know, in my days of first copier sales with the 3M company, you were a pup salesperson. You would talk to the receptionist and the operations guy, but you would not be talking to the business owner who actually made a decision on the machine and wrote the check. Now, I'm not saying that this is an easy concept, especially if you're selling into larger B2C worlds, from that standpoint that typically someone at an upper level of management is going to assign a team to do research before they ever make a purchase on a capital goods item. And that's when it's very much a challenge to get some airtime, if you will, in front of the true decision maker, but you certainly have to make that effort. There is a thought out there that if you can start from the top down and talk to Mr. Jones, who's the CEO, President, Operations VP, and he delegates you down to a lower echelon, a committee, at least you can use his name to the individual that's going to be doing the research on your products and say, Mr. Jones told me to get in touch with you, and then that gives you more validity. So I would encourage you to start from the top down. Even if you don't get to present your product to that individual, you get an internal third-party reference.
Yeah, and so I guess that goes into the accountability side of this, right, Gary? What an important piece of your overall sales management plan, correct?
Yeah, when you look at it, quite frankly, we're all victims of human nature, and you tend to expect what you inspect. And so from that standpoint, if your sales staff has no accountability, no call reports, no reports back to a sales manager, the tendency is to let the details slough and the big details slough. And unfortunately, you just don't get the effort. But if you know that you're going to be called to task, and it doesn't have to be heavy-handed, know that you're accountable to someone, you're more apt to apply your energies, your mindset, and your skill set, because nobody really comes to work wanting to do poorly. And everyone wants to do well, but human nature says we're going to take the course of least resistance. And unfortunately, in sales, that doesn't win you a lot of business. You have to overcome that resistance to win business, and that means accountability.
And I would imagine for a solopreneur like myself and other small business owners that are single teams, that this, their sales manager may become somebody in the coaching field, correct? That's that can bring some accountability and some oversight to their business, right?
That's a distinct possibility. If you know that you've paid someone to help you and coach you along, and you're going to have a weekly or a biweekly meeting, and they're going to ask you, you know, what your sales efforts were, what your numbers were, and we all know the law of averages from the top of the sales funnel down to the close rate, and you're not hitting your numbers, then it just helps to know you're going to be called to task.
Yeah, in a nice way.
In a very nice
way. Baby.
That's good.
That's funny. Yeah, so I just was thinking back to my days in corporate America when quotas and those being held to task were a little bit different than they are today. You know, that just made me think back a little bit. So, all right. So how can you use, if you're using too many metrics, and I'm looking forward to your explanation of this, if you're using too many metrics to measure your sales effort, how does that create these roadblocks for a company?
Well, we're living in a world of metrics and a lot of things that can be measured because simply we're communicating through our cell devices and our computers and these things that are hooked up to corporate measurement capabilities. And from the standpoint of maybe management wanting to do a good job for their stakeholders and having too many mandatory requirements of their sales team, and all of a sudden you find your talented salespeople filling in forms, hitting performance metrics that don't contribute to the actual sale. People tell me that I spend 40% of my time filling out forms or going after customers that I know are not a prospect because that's what the metrics for my job are, and I'm afraid I will lose my job if I don't do those things. And so we're performing for the internal aspects of the company and not what really gains you business. You have to make sure that there's some accountability, but there's not an overwhelming burden on the salesperson to hit all these metrics numbers that don't really contribute to a purchase of your product.
Yeah, awesome. And I know that the next tool anybody that is running any kind of business in today's market needs to have a good tool, a good CRM tool. Why do you consider a CRM to be an important piece of your overall sales effort?
You simply have to have a modern modern day Rolodex. Some people may not even know what that means. I'll tell you real quickly. You'd go into somebody's office and they'd have this little plastic device and it have all these little cards on there, and it had all their people's name, number, address, and phone number on there, not an email address or not a website. And that was a Rolodex. Now it's electronic, it's portable. And if I want to get in touch with someone, then I have that information immediately at fingertips. But even more important, you need to know the progression of the sales process that you're working through. And so if you label that and you know that you've made an initial presentation, or you're overcoming objections, or you're supplying technical information, then you can tell how close you are to getting to a close, or when you have an interaction with a customer and they give you new feedback, you can notate it in your CRM. It can be shared with your sales team, because we rarely are a solo producer anymore. Outside guys have inside coordinators, they have operations people, they have manufacturing people, they have their managers that want to know what's going on with their prospects. And so these things are visible to a lot of people. Also, it doesn't mean that you're just simply hosted on one brands are now, broadcast throughout, and you can log onto those anywhere you're at, or you can ask somebody to take a look at it and they can see where you're at in the sales process. So the sophistication of the CRMs helps you with your overall sales and marketing aspect of things. And it's a communication tool, so you're not chasing each other down to find out what's going on in your account. There's a lot of visibility. Flabbergasted when I meet people who don't have CRM working and they're in sales.
So why don't you run back through, Gary, a little bit about how you help folks. Tell us a little bit about how Trucon helps a business when they contact you, your role, and what you'd like to do for the businesses that you can help.
All right. Just like when you go to the doctor and you say, Doc, I'm not feeling well, help me out, they're going to run you through a series of tests. And so what I will provide for somebody that says, I've got issues, kind of think this is what they are, but I'm not 100% sure, I have a full 30-plus question, strength, weakness, opportunities, threats tool that people can put themselves through and score, give me feedback. And then also have a 20-question, 5 points per question, scale of 0 to 100, aspect of small to medium business enterprise weaknesses that can be corrected. I give that to them. And then in combination with having personal interviews, we find out why we feel like they're not hitting their numbers. And of course, that can be a full variety of things. And then we'll actually engage, whether it be a one-time sit down to say, here's what your top two items are, here are ways to fix that. Or we can have an ongoing situation, perhaps with a salesperson that needs some weekly, monthly help with getting really productive into their territory. Or it can be a sales management issue where that person needs to come up to speed with some aspects of leadership and or just managing their sales team without being a burden to those guys working in the field.
Yeah, and so we've been talking to Gary Seale with Trucon Sales Consulting. And Gary, if you would, one more time, run through your contact information.
All right, very good. My website is truconbdboydavid.com. My email address is trucon, T-R-U-C-O-N, at sbcglobal.net. And my favorite way to communicate is an email. followed by a phone call at 512-219-6677. Calling time, the first interaction on a sales consultation is absolutely no charge.
Super. Now, you know what? This is where I get to have some fun. This is your question. Thank you for running through those questions. But now, toward the end, I always like to have a little bit of fun with my podcast guest. Are you ready for some quick hot questions? Is that cool?
Are they about your dog?
No. They're about you. They're about you. So your latest trip, just where did you go?
I just got back from Yellowstone National Park. It was on my bucket list. My wife and oldest daughter went with us, and we made the top big five there in Yellowstone. It was a really unique experience. We came back really tired. Be prepared to walk a lot. And I took 426 digital photographs.
Awesome.
In a half-day period.
And I was going to ask you, a side hobby of yours is?
Photography. Yeah. I don't impinge on any professional photographers, but that's my hobby, and I enjoy doing it, and love to help out where I can.
Now, when you're out and about in Austin, Gary, do you what are some of your favorite places you like to go eat, and do you go out to any places to hear any kind of special music?
Oh man, we are not. You know, we're kind of like I have Sirius Radio, so in my I have 60s, 80s, Beatles channel, and the hard rock stuff. So you can tell I'm a child of the 60s and 70s. We like Popsitas, Tex-Mex.
Mm-hmm.
We go to County Line with out-of-town guests, Rudy's for regular barbecue. And my wife and I, believe it or not, we go to Rosa's every Saturday morning for a taco, some peace and quiet. And that's our little date time.
That's awesome. And so one last question. So let's go all the way back to high school, okay, before we finish up here. Do you remember your last concert you went to when you were in high school? Do you have any remembrance of what that might have been or who that was?
Okay, so I didn't start going to concerts until I was in college.
Okay, college.
I get to see some of the biggies. I get to see Led Zeppelin, ZZ Top.
Wow.
Booze, Three Dog Night, Elton John, you know, and probably the best concert we ever went to was probably like 1986, was Paul McCartney in Texas Stadium.
That's cool.
Concert ever, yeah.
So Gary's an old-time rocker, man. There you go. Okay. Hey, listen, I wanted to thank you for being on the podcast, Gary. Really appreciate you coming on tonight and taking time with us to share about your business and some of these important questions for business. Guys, if you're a business in Austin and want to be on the Austin Biz Buzz, and that's right, we build the buzz about Austin business, it starts with an email. You can AustinBizBuzz @gmail.com and just put in a subject line, I'd like to be a guest on your show, and we'll make it happen from there. So, Gary, thanks for being on. Hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you, and thanks to Michael Neal.
All right, guys. Y'all have a good evening, and we'll see you. Well, we won't see you, but you'll hear us on the podcast next week on the Austin Biz Buzz. And everybody, good night.